I warned you not to listen to that, Kits My Goat. Now look at you.
Hey, everybody, this is Big Anglovich.
And Rich Outfield.
Welcome to another...
exciting episode.
That's the word I was exciting. That was better than inane. Episode of That Gets My Goat.
And I believe you are driving today.
Well,
the show, not the car.
Yeah, the car unfortunately is driving nowhere right now. How about that? Good times.
You and I, for some reason, are brothers in this.
Yeah.
My car is in the shop. And your car died in the parking lot, so...
Yeah, on the way here. How about that? But that's not... I mean, that does get my goat when my car does something like that, but that's not what we're here for. I wanted to talk a wee bit about... This is an experience that I had this week, and it was really inspiring to me. So I thought, you know, we talk about that kind of stuff often enough on our show, so I figured I'd bring it to the show and ask you what you thought of it. Maybe you'll think I'm a nut job. Maybe you'll think, this is what inspired you? You must be really hard up for something because you're just grasping at anything. I don't know. Maybe you won't think that.
I'm inspired by the guy who was too fat to fly. So
okay, well, there you go. So anyways, this week I was on Facebook and my nephew says, hey,
Uncle?
No, he didn't. He just said, hey, see you all later. I'm gone for 10 days. I'm off to Burning Man.
10 days?
I think it goes on for quite some time. I don't know how long, but yeah, he was heading out for Burning Man. I mentioned that to my wife and she was like, Burning Man? What the hell is a Burning Man?
Gaby.
And so I was like, wow, really? You never heard of Burning Man? You don't know anything about it? You don't know what that is? And so I was like, okay. And I started describing it to her. I was like, you know, it's this kind of like a festival. And then I realized, you know what? I should just show her stuff from Burning Man because that's really probably the best way to do that. So I got on YouTube and I searched Burning Man. And the first video that came up was...
Not safe for work.
NSFW. No, I searched Burning Man and like the top thing on there was a video called Oh, the Places You'll Go at Burning Man. And so I thought, oh, let's click on that one. And I clicked on that one and we watched this. And my wife was like watching it and she's just like, what the heck is this? This is weird. And there's, you know, just the standard stuff that you might get at Burning Man. There's a woman who's no shirt. She has like some kind of...
Four leaf
clovers.
Oh,
covering her nipples.
Okay,
and that's it. And I was like, "Whoa!" She's like, "What is the deal with everybody is almost naked or naked in this?" And I was just like, "Hey, I told you this is Burning Man." But yeah, as it went on, in the middle of it, I got up and walked out. Then I came back at the end, and my wife left, and the end came on, and it was finishing up, and all of a sudden, I found myself crying. It suddenly struck me like this. Now, Oh, the Places You'll Go, if you don't realize what it is before now, it's not just this movie, but it's the Dr. Seuss story. And what they do in this video is they have a bunch of different people reading the lines to Oh, the Places You'll Go at Burning Man.
And then they edited it together.
And they edited it all together. And it's really well done. It's really cool. It's got a really nice soundtrack. What I actually want to do is... just take the audio of it and play it. When me and you go to watch it is when we'll play the audio for everybody. Hopefully that's okay. I don't know if that's piracy or what, or if somebody's going to put up a stink about it.
Well, but if anybody listened to the show,
yeah,
they would be free to stink.
Yes, but I hope that that's not the case. If that's a problem, then I guess we'll take the episode down when somebody sends us a cease and desist letter. I don't know, but... you know, I've known of this book all along, and I'm sure I've read it probably 4 or 5 times in my life, but I never realized just how awesome it is and how inspiring it is. But this particular thing was even more inspiring. Like, I clicked on it and I watched it, and then one of the comments that I saw at the bottom was, well, why don't you check out this book here? And it had a link to another reading of it. It said, read by the author. And I was like, whoa, it was read by Dr. Seuss? I totally want to hear that. And I put it in. It was actually read by John Lithgow. So I don't know why they would say that. Because it even says, read by John Lithgow. So it's not like you can be like, oh, I think that's by Dr. Seuss. No, it was obviously not. But it wasn't nearly as inspiring when read by John Lithgow for some reason. But this Burning Man thing just, it blew me away. And I was totally inspired by this. Now, we'll watch it now. We'll put the audio on for everybody, and then we'll come back, and I will talk about how it inspired me, what it inspired me to do, or whatever. And you can weigh in on it, too, since you'll have seen it and know whether you were inspired or not, or anyway. So we'll be back on the flip side.
Tie-dye flips.
Congratulations.
Today is your day.
You're off to great places.
You're off and away.
You have brains in your head. You have feet in your shoes. You can steer yourself in any direction you choose.
You're on your own, and you know what you know. And you are the guy who will decide where to go.
You'll look up and down streets, look them over with care. But some you will say, I don't choose to go there. With your head full of brains and your shoes full of feet, you're too smart to go down a not-so-good street.
And you may not find any you'll want to go down. In that case, of course, you'll head straight out of town. It's opener there in the wide open air.
Out there, things can happen.
And frequently do.
To people as brainy and footsie as you.
When things start to happen, don't worry, don't stew, just go right along, you'll start happening too.
Oh, the places you'll go.
You'll be on your way up, you'll be seeing great sights, and you'll join the high flyers who soar to high heights.
You won't lag behind because you'll have all the speed. You'll pass the whole gang and you'll soon take the lead. Wherever you fly, you'll be the best of the best. Wherever you go, you'll top all the rest.
Except when you don't.
Because sometimes you won't.
I am sorry to say so, but sadly it is true that bang-ups and hang-ups can happen to you.
You can get all hung up in a prickly perch, and your gang will fly on. You'll be left in a lurch.
You'll come down from the lurch with an unpleasant bump, and the chances are then that you'll be in a slump.
When you're in a slump, you're not in for much fun. Unslumping yourself is not easily done.
You will come to a place where the streets are not marked. Some windows are lighted, but mostly they're dark. A place you could sprain both your elbow and chin. Do you dare to stay out? Do you dare to go in? How much can you lose? How much can you win?
And if you go in, should you turn left or right? Or right and three quarters? Or maybe not quite? Or go around back and sneak in from behind? Simple it's not, I'm afraid you will find. For a mind maker upper to make up her mind.
You can get so confused that you'll start to race down long-wheeled roads at a breaknecking pace and grind on for miles across weirdish wild space, headed, I fear, towards a most useless place.
The waiting place for people just waiting.
Waiting for a train to go, or a bus to come, or a plane to go.
Or the mail to come, or the rain to go, or the phone to ring.
Or the snow to snow, or waiting around for yes or no, or waiting for their hair to grow. Everyone is just waiting.
Waiting for the fish to bite.
Or waiting for the wind to fly a kite.
Or waiting around for Friday night.
Or waiting perhaps for their Uncle Jake.
Or a pot to boil.
Or a better break.
Or a string of pearls.
Or a pair of pants.
Or a wig with curls.
Or another chance.
Everyone is just waiting.
No, that's not for you. Somehow you'll escape all that's waiting and staying. You'll find the bright places where boom bands are playing. Banner flip flapping. Once more, you'll ride high. Ready for anything under the sky. Ready because you're that kind of guy.
Now the places will go. There is fun to be done. There are points to be scored. There are games to be won.
And the magical things you'll do with this ball will make you the winningest winner of all.
Fame. You'll be famous as famous can be, with the whole wide world watching you win on TV.
Except when they don't, because sometimes they won't.
I'm afraid that sometimes you'll play lonely games too. Games you can't win, because you'll play against you.
All alone, whether you like it or not.
Alone will be something you'll be quite a lot.
And when you're alone, there's a very good chance you'll meet things that scare you right out of your pants. There are some down the road between hither and yon that scare you so much you won't want to go on.
But on you will go, though the weather be foul. On you will go, though your enemies prowl. On you will go, though the hack cracks howl. Onward up many a frightening creek, though your arms may get sore and your sneakers may leak. On you will hike, and I know you'll hike far, and face up to your problems, whatever they are.
You'll get mixed up, of course, as you already know. You'll get mixed up with many strange birds as you go.
So be sure when you step with care and great tact. And remember that life's a great balancing act.
Just never forget to be dexterous and deft, and never mix up your right foot with your left.
And will you succeed?
Yes, you will indeed.
98.75% guaranteed.
Kid, you'll move mountains. So be your name, Boxbaum.
Or Bixby.
Or Bray.
Or Mordecai Ale Van Allen O'Shea.
You're off to great places. Today is your day. Your mountain is waiting. So get on your way.
And we're back.
It's hard to imagine, though it's often told, that I could realize exactly how old I've become in the last few years, it would seem. It's all flown by like some spectacular dream. And watching this video has made me think.
Wow, William Shatner's back.
Spock, I could really use a strong drink with... All right, I'm sorry, I can't do that. No, it did make me seem old. All those people, except for one, were so much younger than us.
Well, yeah, and there were a few old hippies in that. There was I would say five or six, not just one, that outranked us.
When 900 years old you reach, look as good you will not.
But yeah, it's not something probably that's for us. I don't know that that would be our scene, per se.
I went to Lollapalooza in 1992, and it was really similar to that, except for I think I wore a shirt.
That's because it wasn't in the middle of the Nevada desert.
No, it was in Phoenix, Arizona. And so, yeah, it was the middle of the Nevada desert. What story was that?
Every story. Okay. Any story that has Nevada in it is in the middle of the Nevada desert.
All right. And yeah, that is the first thing that jumps to mind is, you know, a look at these hippies.
Right. And that's kind of what my point was in showing it to my wife, because she had no idea what Burning Man was. So I thought anything really would be a good thing. And I was showing it to her. I did not expect to be suddenly inspired and brought to tears over it. To be moved.
And she was out of the room by the time
she was.
Finally...
she was already. She'd watched it for a while. I mean, it was
she
what,
made
seven...
the hand gesture and she got the hell out. She was already in REM sleep.
It was like 7 minutes long. I think she'd gone to take a shower already by that point. And I came back and sat down and saw the end of it. And all of a sudden I was bawling. I don't know what it was. I walked in there and the stuff that he talks about in there is so fitting to someone who wants to be doing something creatively, or maybe even not creatively, just someone who wants to do something. If you want to have a life that's worth talking about, that's worth at the end of the life saying, yeah, this is what I did, and I did this, and I did this, maybe you should get up each morning and read this story before you head out. I actually captured the audio of that. And I put it on my iPod.
Oh, for when you're running?
Not for when I'm running, but just for whenever. And I listened to it several times since I saw that the first time. And I think it also may be just the way these people read the lines. Because like I said, I went to the John Lithgow one. And
it didn't grab you in
the
same
way. It
was
read like a kid's story. Like, oh, congratulations. Today is your day. You know, and he was doing it all fun and goofy. And, you know, the kind of the way you would read a Dr. Seuss story to a little kid. But the way they took it in this video is they were just like, this is magical. This is inspiring. This is you being the best that you can be. And the line at the end when he says, if your name is this, that, you know, or Mordecai Ali Van Allen O'Shea. And then he says, you're off to great places. Today is your day. Your mountain is waiting. So get on your way. And I don't know, there's something so inspiring about those lines. Just, it's there, and you're going to be doing great things. 98.75% guaranteed. You know, get out there. Well, except when you don't.
I do really like the when you don't parts. How it'll just stop.
Yeah.
And they'll say, except for when you don't.
Because sometimes you won't. That's true. And obviously, we've talked on this show endlessly about our writing aspirations and our writing difficulties and
our writing excuses.
Oh, there you go. Our troubles with staying motivated and really living up to our potential, I would say. Obviously, as soon as I started hearing this, I started applying it to that. And, you know, my wife, like I said, she went and took a shower. I saw the end of it and I went, whoa, I actually played it again and watched it through and listened to it. And yeah, the whole way I was just inspired and I was crying in multiple places at this point, but especially every time I hear that ending line, the mountain is waiting, so get on your way. And yeah, it's there. You know, people have climbed mountains for a long time for no good reason. And I want to say that the first guy who summited
Sir Edmund Hillary,
wasn't it him that where they said, why did you climb Mount Everest? And his response was because it was there. Yeah, it's this great thing that needs to be done. We talked about Neil Armstrong on the show recently. And, you know, this amazing thing that he accomplished, going to the moon. Why would you go to the moon?
We do these things not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
That was something that always stuck with me. Kennedy saying, we go to the moon and do these other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because man's reach has to exceed his grasp, that you always have to move forward and try to do more than you have done, because entropy is the natural state of the universe. It's so easy to just lay back and watch yourself get fatter and older and more useless in my case. It's hard to push yourself and say, you know what? No, I'm going to go another block, or I'm going to write another hour, or
I'm going to run another mile or whatever.
Fill in the blank. You do that stuff. Most of the time, there's no financial recompense, or there's nobody that's going to be waiting at the finish line for you. The reason you do it is because it's hard.
And because it's hard is what makes it worthwhile. If it was easy, well, who cares? Anybody could do it. Anybody who didn't even try could do it because it's easy. And so there's no accomplishment. There's no worth to it. But if you have a dream and you put your mind to it, 98.75% guaranteed, you can achieve it. It will be worth it. You can climb that mountain, and the mountain, it's theirs. And that's the other thing that really inspires me about that ending quote. Not only is the mountain waiting, but you got to get on your way. Okay? Don't sit in the waiting place like all those people. You wind up in the waiting place waiting for a wig with curls.
Waiting for the wind to fly your kite?
Yeah, waiting for wind to fly a kite, waiting for a train to come or a plane to go or all the stupid things that you can. And sometimes I feel like that's where I live is the waiting place. The time where I'm just like, oh, if I just had this, then I would be the writer. If I just did that, then I would do the thing that I wanted to. I guess I don't have to be too down on myself, because sometimes I get that way when I'm being inspired, which is weird. But I've done things even recently that I can be proud of. There was a time not too long ago that I was almost 300 friggin' pounds. I was 12 stone. I don't know what a stone is, so that's probably totally wrong. But yeah, just the other day, I was at work and there was a guy that used to work with me. And then he went and he got a job elsewhere. And then out of the blue, he was back. He started freelancing with the station again. And I saw him the other day and he's like, whoa, hey, I haven't seen you in forever. And I was like, yeah, good to see you. And he's like, yeah, where's the rest of you? He hadn't seen me since I was about 300 pounds. Now I'm 60 pounds lighter than that. And I'm still not done. It's something that I'm still working on. So there's something that I can be proud of. You know, I'm actually pretty close to, if not the same as, the weight that I got married at 14 years ago.
14.
Isn't that how long it's been since 1998?
I was told there would be no math.
So, I mean, there's things. But as I watched that and I teared up and bawled and I just thought, why
am I not climbing that mountain that I want to climb? I have my aspiration. I know what I want to do. I just need to do it. Like I said, I grabbed the audio and I put it on my iPod so that I could listen to it again and again and be inspired. And I was listening to it in the car this morning on the way to work, and I still teared up at the end. It still gets me. When we just watched it now, slightly misty-eyed, I tried to compose myself so I didn't embarrass myself in front of the great Rish Outfield. But
wait, it seems like I cried on an episode once, didn't I?
Oh, I'm sure you
were
have.
Were we talking about something? And I told you...
Oh, I don't remember what it was. It was that time where we did the contest of who could kick each other in the nuts the hardest contest. Oh. I think you cried after I kicked you in the nuts.
And if I didn't, there's something wrong.
No, I'm sure you've cried multiple times over various things that we've talked about, but there was just something super inspiring. I don't know if other people that are listening are inspired by it as well at all.
Well, it's hard to identify what inspires each person, you know, what somebody is going to respond to. And I know that's something we've talked about many times, especially when I call you and I say, hey, Kevin Smith just said cock and then this. And I was really inspired by the second part. And you're just like, yeah, but what did he say first?
Yeah. And the funny thing is, this is a kid's book. It's a child's plaything. And
I don't think so, though. I think he wrote this at the end of his life as like a legacy for advice for the young or something like that.
Yeah.
And it's become a tradition to give it to kids or when they graduate high school. I know my mom gave me All the Places You'll Go on my high school graduation, and your mom would have done the same. I'm sure it was a big thing in those days.
Oh, yeah. It was the in thing. So well, we weren't very cool. We usually did like the not in thing.
Well, that's true. She would have given you a library book version of it. But it's just something that you give to somebody to hopefully open their eyes to the possibilities and be your best self. And just the places you'll go, the looking at someone who's young and hasn't lived the years you've lived and said, you can do so much more than I did. Is that not what every old person, except for Neil Armstrong, would do? And it's funny. I mean, just the Neil Armstrong thing, we keep going back to it because when we're recording this, he just died.
Mm-hmm.
And we had just done an episode where we talked about landing on the moon and him never having to buy a drink for himself again. And the man was 38 when he walked on the moon, was the very first person to ever do that. And then he retired from the space program and he went and he became a teacher. And after a while, he retired from that and he was just a farmer and he didn't do interviews or anything like that anymore. And I thought about it the other day, the day that he died, I thought about, well, how do you follow that up where you do something that no one has ever done and everyone on earth knows who you are and you're 38? What do you do with the rest of your life? And in his case, whatever you want, I guess.
Yeah, I would
think so. You relax,
so.
You spend time with your family, you contemplate, you look up at the moon, and you look at the moon differently than all the rest of us do, but at the same time, it's the same moon. And
remember what I said about the scooching kids. Good night.
Good night, moon. Good night, Neil Armstrong. Sorry.
Whoa.
I just don't want people to mistake it for Shatner. To me, that was really inspiring. I don't know why. But just he died and his family said, you know, the next time that you go outside and you look up at the moon, think of Neil. And for some reason, there was something super sweet, sad, but not sad at all about that think of Neil thing. And I don't know. That was really neat.
We'll have to look up at the moon in a bit when we go on our walk and
yeah,
think of him.
I'm never going to do something that no one else has done like he did. It's
but you
so
will do things that no one else has done. That I can guarantee you've probably done hundreds of them already. And you will continue to do things that no one else has done. I mean, you could say every story that you wrote, no one else will write that story. Every time you step out there and you do that, you're doing something that no one else has done and no one else will do.
Don't you think a real writer would dream of writing the story that I wrote and then wake up and go, oh, it's just a dream. Oh,
goodness.
What a horrible nightmare.
To be continued.
That Gets My Goat is produced under a Creative Commons 3.0 license. Doesn't have to be, but it is.
Man, I'm getting sicker as the hours go by.
Oh, you were going to call in sick tomorrow because of the car and being ill, right?
Yeah, well, I was already ill today.
I don't think you ever told me that.
I almost called in sick earlier, and I just thought, I'll go. But yeah, it's getting worse.
Oh, the places you'll hoe.